Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents What Works, a comprehensive framework to change the way we approach goal setting, by Tara McMullin, narrated by Christina Delaine. Limit of liability / disclaimer of warranty. While the publisher and author have used their best efforts in preparing this book, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this book, and specifically disclaim any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives or written sales materials. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a professional where appropriate. Neither the publisher nor author shall be liable for any loss of profit or any other commercial damages, including but not limited to special, incidental, consequential, or other damages. We have been trained too long to strive and not to enjoy. John Maynard Keynes. Adjustment, I think. Now that really is the story of my life. Catherine May. Introduction. Our culture is obsessed with goals. Achievement, growth, change, improvement. For a long time, I shared that obsession. But about 5 years ago, I started to question whether the goals I set and the constant impulse to strive for more genuinely served me. Was I happier? Was I more fulfilled? Was I a better business owner, wife, mother, daughter, friend, because of the goals I held? Those were pretty easy questions to answer. No, no, and no. Then I started to ask more difficult questions. Why do I fixate on goals? What drives my constant need for achievement? How do the goals I pursue alienate me from others and even myself? As I explored those questions, both through personal reflection and thorough research, I came to a startling hypothesis. Maybe goal setting doesn't work. Maybe goal setting is wrapped up in the same stories and systems that make it such a challenge to find satisfaction and fulfillment in modern life. Maybe I need a whole new approach. This isn't another book about how to set goals and achieve them. My guess is that you've already read quite a few. You bought the planners, used the apps, and found yourself an accountability buddy. If you're like any of the thousands of people I've heard from over the last decade, you're probably still wondering, okay, but what works? What really works to change habits? What really works to achieve goals? What really works to create plans that I can stick to or fit in all the responsibilities I have? I like that you ask questions. Here's the thing, though. I firmly believe that there are a lot more questions to ask before we find answers to those questions, if we even need to answer them at all. This book is about those questions, the questions about cultural narratives and moral systems, the questions about what hole we're trying to fill when we keep adding more responsibilities to our plates. The questions about whether society's shoulds and supposed tos are worth pursuing. The questions about how to approach life and work in a society where so many face incredible burdens. This book is also what I've found works for me, and hundreds of others I've shared it with. It's a springboard that you can use to find what works for you, too. But before we can get there, I need to tell you a story. It's a story about me, the way my mind works, and how the analysis I share in this book isn't a product of a special talent for accomplishment, but instead a product of pain and doubt. Shoot for the moon. In my junior year of college, a library staff member recruited me as an independent consultant for a makeup and skincare company. I loved makeup, and I liked the idea of being in control of my income. Plus, I'd worked retail for years, so I figured I had some transferable skills. I paid for my starter kit, as well as some additional samples, and attended my first meeting. That first meeting was the pep rally I didn't know I needed. The cheap hotel conference room shimmered with potential and positive energy. My confidence surged. I was going to make it. My recruiter could tell I was ready to go all in. She invited me to be her guest at a bigger regional meeting in a bigger cheap hotel ballroom. While the first meeting was led by my recruiter's recruiter, this second meeting was hosted by someone much farther up the line. And this gathering was special because there was a guest speaker. If memory serves me, the guest speaker was a power player in the company, a woman with the fancy car of a certain color, a massive downline, and plenty of material success. As a sheltered 20-year-old, I'd never heard motivational speaking outside of altar calls at Christian rock festivals. I was transfixed. This woman seemed to have the answer to all of life's biggest questions, and she believed that each of us in attendance had what it took to make it big. I am easily swept up by that kind of energy and rhetoric. I suppose most people are. That's why it works. And by works, I mean that it works to stir people up and make them more susceptible to risk-taking. After the event, as we walked toward her car, I told my recruiter how excited I was by what I'd heard. I didn't want to just sell makeup. I wanted to have it all. She reached into the trunk of her car and pulled out a cassette tape. "I think you'll like this," she said. It was a recording of a similar speaker, saying similar things, but now the motivation was on demand. I'd play the tape over and over again. I learned that I'm the only one responsible for my success and failure. I learned that if I worked hard enough, I could get whatever I wanted. I learned the makeup company's founder had herself said, "Shoot for the moon and you'll land among the stars." I liked that, even if it was astronomically inaccurate. It wasn't until at least a decade later that I learned the founder did not originate that phrase. She merely borrowed it from Norman Vincent Peale. Like every multi-level marketing company, the company I signed up with has a clear way to ladder up in the organization. I liked that, too. Promotions weren't up to chance. If I wanted to move up, the requirements were right there in black and white. Each rung in the beauty ladder also came with an external reward. The first was the honor of donning a red blazer at official events. When you wore the red blazer to an event, everyone knew what rank you were, how committed you were to success. I earned my red blazer quickly and set my sights on earning a sporty little car, just like my recruiter had recently earned. My success was short-lived, though. As a college student, I just didn't know enough people to sell to or, more importantly, recruit. And as a painfully awkward and socially anxious person, I wasn't equipped to network my way to knowing more people. I was queasy about the few women I had recruited. Even though I knew it was up to them to succeed, I felt responsible for them. I didn't want them to have wasted their time or money because I had listened to some motivational tapes. But sooner than later, I faced reality. I wasn't cut out for this particular grift. My recruiter convinced me not to sell my product back to the company. She was already dangerously close to losing her new car, and if I'd officially quit, she'd be on the hook for a car payment. Boxes of lotions, lipsticks, foundations, and samples sat in the closet of my mom's house for years after that. I didn't throw them away until after I graduated, got married, had a baby, and separated, moving back in with my mom. For years, those boxes were visual reminders that I wasn't good enough to succeed. Unknowingly, I carried that shame and doubt with me for years. I'm not the first person to lose at the game of multi-level marketing. 99% of people do. It's easy to get sold on the energy, the community, the potential, enough so that you forget the impossible math of the MLM system standing in your way. When you inevitably quit, all of the programming that you gorged yourself on in the beginning turns on you. Now you're lazy. You're not committed. You've lost faith. In many ways, A multi-level marketing scheme is a microcosm of what many of us experience every day in our culture at large. We learn the path and visualize our success. We devour the positive messages and seek the wisdom of mentors farther up the ladder. We work hard, and harder still. And when stress or burnout or the reality of an economy that only works for a few becomes too much to bear, we step back, knowing we weren't good enough or strong enough. We didn't want it bad enough. We didn't think the right thoughts or manifest the right results. We blame ourselves because that's what we've been taught to do. The Secret by Rhonda Byrne debuted in 2006 and since has sold over 35 million copies. After Byrne appeared on Oprah twice, the book and DVD flew off shelves. In fact, I remember just how fast it flew because I was managing a Borders Books and Music at the time. Case after case of the book appeared on our loading dock, and just as soon as we'd get the books out on the floor, they'd be gone again. I can also remember, early in the craze, hiding out in the back room with a few coworkers to figure out what was going on with this book. What was all this fuss about? We suspected The Secret was no literary or philosophical masterpiece. I cracked open a copy and read out loud. We howled. Our suspicions were correct. The Secret was a great product, but not a great idea. The Secret brought the law of attraction to the mass market. The law of attraction, according to Byrne and her ersatz academy of teachers, taught that you could have anything you wanted by thinking about and visualizing it intensely enough. And any hardships or negative experience was also the result of your own manifestation. Your pessimistic thoughts and fears created your undesirable reality. The Secret was not, is not, as Byrne has continued to release books, films, and three apps, an isolated craze. It's merely the slick repackaging of a message that's been bubbling in the waters of American culture for 150 years called New Thought. Early proponents of New Thought believed in the power of the mind to heal the body. As historian Kate Bowler explains, New Thought taught that the world should be reimagined as thought rather than substance. The spiritual world formed absolute reality, while the material world was the mind's projection. While New Thought's adherents, like the teachers of The Secret, would point to ancient wisdom, both Judeo-Christian beliefs and Eastern religion, as the source of their knowledge, it should be understood as a distinct, colonial, and capitalist phenomenon. New Thought didn't stop at championing the mind cure for disease or the divinity of the self as true self-actualization. By the early 20th century, New Thought became a more explicitly economic teaching, too. Bowler calls this new iteration an American gospel based on hard work, pragmatism, innovation, self-reliance, and openness to risk. The problem with positive thinking. One of the runaway bestsellers that preached this new gospel was Norman Vincent Peale's The Power of Positive Thinking. Peale's book is full of scriptural one-liners turned into positive affirmations, as well as rags-to-riches stories of men who were down on their luck and turned everything around once they discovered they could just think happy and wealthy thoughts. In the same vibrational wavelength of his pseudo-spiritual progeny, Peale writes, "The secret is to fill your mind with thoughts of faith, confidence, and security." And while I was surprised to discover that Peale is slightly more generous to structural burdens than those that came later, his book also contains nuggets like this one. It is appalling to realize the number of pathetic people who are hampered and made miserable by the malady popularly called the inferiority complex. Or, disability, tension, and kindred troubles may result from a lack of inner harmony. If this all sounds familiar, it's because it's woven into the fabric of our economic, cultural, and political systems today. While Peale, Byrne, and other proponents of New Thought like to remind us that our negative thoughts create undesirable realities, They are actively creating a theory of self that puts the blame for suffering and adversity on us. If I'm to be completely responsible for my own success or lack thereof, how I respond to failure will naturally be to condemn myself. And it was from that self-loathing that one early morning at the gym, I found myself Googling, "Can I change my personality?" There was a not insignificant part of me that believed I could think my way to a personality more suited to success, that it was my own deficiency of character that had led to my mental anguish. With more than 5 years' distance from that morning, I can see how extreme and unreasonable that pervasive thought was. But I've learned since that it is simply the air we breathe in 21st century America. It was certainly the air I was breathing at the gym, where the gospel of thinness hangs like a sweaty stench in that same air. Now, to be clear, I am a huge supporter of mindset work. I believe that the way I think about things does impact my actions, which has the power to create the results I desire. But I don't engage with the power of positive thinking type of mindset work that floods our Instagram and Twitter feeds, nor do I ignore the material obstacles in my path. Instead, I hone my mindset through critical thinking and analysis. I ask copious questions and pick apart assumptions. If someone comes up with a brilliant strategy or a compelling business move, I consider what questions they asked to come up with it. I work through what base knowledge they possess that's different from my own. I don't believe that believing in myself is a precondition for rational or strategic thought. When I'm truly engaging those critical thinking skills, I'm much less likely to blame myself for failure. I'm less likely to fixate on my own shortcomings or how to overcome them. Critical thinking created a more satisfying life for me than positive thinking ever could. There are things I wish were different about me, things that make it difficult to access what others find so worthwhile. I wish I understood others' emotions better. I wish it were easier to connect with new people. I wish I didn't find myself overstimulated and overwhelmed at conferences or parties. I wish I had a softer focus and didn't have such a hard time being interrupted or switching tasks. I wish I had just a few of the traits I so admire in others, but are utterly baffled by when it comes to myself. Yet I've also come to realize that I am satisfied without these things. I don't actually possess a deep longing for a wide circle of friends or focus better suited to multitasking. I don't need to overcome these obstacles because they're not truly obstacles to my satisfaction. That said, I can't remember a time when I didn't feel a fundamental brokenness about who I am. I can't remember a time or a place when I felt like I belonged to any group or community. I often don't feel at home in my closest relationships. I'm always on edge, trying to figure out what others want from me, and hopelessly trying to contort myself into that shape. This unease has plagued me throughout my life. As a kid, I perpetually felt on the outside looking in. As a teen, I felt so angry at the world for not having a place for me. As a young adult, I started to feel the weight of isolation and contemplated suicide. And now, as I approach middle age, I have days when I just feel hopeless. It's probably no wonder, then, that I have dealt with depression and anxiety for as long as I felt separate, other, unwanted. I reached an acute awareness of whom I believe I should be to belong, as well as the not-so-sneaking suspicion that I am fundamentally not that person. Before you assume that I am a drearily unhappy person who has found no success in life, I can assure you that that's not the case. I have been known to cackle with laughter, especially at puns or cutting jokes about the difficulties of being a woman. I run 2 successful businesses. I am happily married to a wonderful partner, and I'm the proud mama of an absolutely incredible 14-year-old girl. In so many ways, my life is good, and I'm quite happy. I'm quite happy, except when I'm not. And when I'm not is when I'm reminded just how out of place I am. When I'm not is when I feel like things would be so much easier if I were just a different person. This tension between satisfaction and contentment on one side and despair on the other confounds many people around me. I'm profoundly misunderstood because I exist somewhere on this spectrum of extremes. So again, I consider what it would take to become someone else. Recently, I learned something about myself that brought all of this into focus. I'm autistic. Thanks to the brave firsthand accounts of women diagnosed as adults, I finally discovered the framework that makes sense of my whole experience of brokenness and not belonging. I'm especially grateful to Catherine May and her memoir, The Electricity of Every Living Thing, as well as Amy Richards of the Square Peg podcast. And while this framework does nothing to fix those feelings on its own, it does give me a much healthier way of processing my difference, as well as a sustainable way to understand better who I am and how I want to grow. I don't want to change who I am, though I'd be glad to know her better. But I do want to grow as a human, and a leader, a wife, a mom, and a friend. I want to practice different ways to engage with the world and make sense of what happens around me. I want to become more me, and maybe for the first time, discover what that truly means. So even though my Googling about personality change came up short, I can tie that cringy inspiration to the path that would lead me to discover my own process for self-exploration, growth, and satisfaction. This book is that path and my process. You don't need to be autistic to use it, and it might very well not be a perfect fit for many autistic people or other neurodivergent people. It also might not be a perfect fit for plenty of neurotypical people, people from underestimated groups, people of varied genders or abilities or family structures. No, I can't guarantee this process will be a perfect fit. But I can guarantee that this process is rooted in questioning everything we've ever learned about life design, goals, or planning, because I've had to question everything to create my own path. Asking questions is my superpower, if I do say so myself. And I will offer you plenty of questions to ask yourself as the book unfolds. I aim to help you find the practice and process that works for the kind of growth you're looking for. I want to help give structure and meaning to growth based on curiosity instead of achievement. And I want to show you how so much of what we've all learned about goals, productivity, and personal growth is rooted in harmful narratives about what it takes to be worthy in our modern society. Achievement is my middle name. Ultimately, my investigation of whether I could become someone different led to discovering that I had a toxic relationship to goals. Goals had become a way for me to feel like I fit in or had something to contribute to the group. Whether I aimed to make more money, earn a new accolade, or break into a new social group, my goal provided me with a clear-cut way of engaging with the world. It helped me control the uncontrollable, which in turn put me at some ease in situations that would otherwise be overwhelming to me. My history with goal setting is complicated. On the one hand, I'm a goal-oriented overachiever obsessed with passing the next milestone on the path to success and belonging. On the other hand, I'm prone to anxiety, burnout, and a single-mindedness that can seriously damage my relationships, all exacerbated by my attempts to reach my goals at any cost. How could I be anything else? Goal setting is often the keystone organizing factor of our lives and work, so much so that many of us use our orientation to goals as a way to identify ourselves. We set goals, make plans, and learn how to execute, a never-ending cycle of future-focused striving. We read books on how to choose goals and make plans. We listen to the podcasts with productivity experts and mindset coaches. We watch glitzy TED Talks to fuel the fire of our ambition, or the ambition we think we're supposed to have. My tendency is toward the dogged, and often neurotic, pursuit of goals. But those with a more even temperament get caught up in the frenzy, too. Who am I without a goal? In addition to giving me a way to fit into the world, working toward a goal gave me a way to shake off the persistent sense of precarity that comes from moving through a society that seems to be on ever shakier ground. It gives me a way to feel like I have some control over the future, some agency in how my life turns out. When I strive toward a goal, I have purpose and direction. It's how I learned to cope, and how I learned to win praise from others. My first taste of the kind of recognition I could get from being better, smarter, or stronger came toward the end of fifth grade. I was bored out of my mind in school, and I was starting to disengage. My teachers and my mom could tell there was something wrong, and that, just maybe, they could do something about it. They made the decision. I would skip sixth grade and go straight to junior high school. While I've come to know that this wasn't all that out of the ordinary, it didn't happen in my school district. I was the first student the administration had allowed to skip a grade in a very long time. When I got on the bus going to the junior high school on that first day of school, the other kids tried to tell me I was on the wrong bus. I happily told them I was where I was supposed to be. At school, the gifted teacher recommended that I not tell people about skipping a grade. But enough people knew me, and knew that I didn't used to be in the same grade as them, that staying quiet was impossible. I quickly earned a reputation as the kid who skipped a grade. It wasn't a good reputation. Other kids viewed my accomplishment with a mixture of disdain, jealousy, and mild fascination. I was different, separate from the normal kids, and part of me liked it that way. Of course, part of me hated it, too. I soon started to recognize that setting and achieving goals was a way to maintain my difference and separation. I liked standing apart, even if I also felt a deep desire to belong. Accomplishment gave me a way of, sort of, having both. The more I accomplished, the more I marked myself as a valuable community member and someone special. I externalized my yet unspoken feelings of brokenness and separation in every goal I set and achieved. I focused on being the first chair trombonist in high school, climbing over other players to get to the top. In college, my goal was to be in charge of the weekly worship services on campus, while also being the top student in the religion department. Oh, and the drum major, too. In my over-before-it-began graduate school experience, I realized that I was missing the instruction manual for achieving at that level. Worrying that I wasn't good enough for or worthy of the program that accepted me, I quit. Quitting graduate school led to work in retail. There, that siren song of promotion after promotion kept me from seeing that I was climbing a ladder that made me physically ill. My chronic depression came roaring back, and I developed a serious problem with disordered eating. Is there something in how I describe myself and my relationship to achievement that's familiar to you? Maybe you can see yourself in it. You, too, are achievement-oriented, competitive, and ambitious. Or maybe you see someone you love in that description, or someone you can't stand. Perhaps this description is precisely how you don't want other people to talk about you. 5 years ago, I started questioning whether building my life around goals and achievement was serving me. I wondered whether the achievements I chose for goals were based on my desire, or whether I was just trying to keep up with, or leap over, my peers. Is this really what I want? Or am I just doing what I'm supposed to do? I examined whether working toward future goals was affording me the day-to-day life I wanted. I investigated why I often sabotaged my efforts to reach my goals and got in my own way. Ultimately, this is the path that led me to Googling about changing my personality. Again, you might be entertaining some of these questions right now, too. Or maybe these are precisely the kind of questions that you've worked to avoid as you eschew goal setting, competition, and ambition altogether. Either way, I think we can all agree that there's got to be a better way. Sure, goals help us make plans and structure our lives, but at what cost? There has got to be a way that allows us to find focus and balance, to give us a sense of direction and find satisfaction in our present location. What works? That was the quest I set out on, to find a new way to plan, work, and organize my life that didn't revolve around externalizing deeply personal questions. This book is everything I learned in that process and the framework I now use to orient myself and my actions. Getting to this point has been a complicated learning process. Being an achievement-oriented, hyper-competitive, winning-is-my-personal-identity type of person has given me a way to make sense of myself and the world. Setting goals and racing toward the finish line was just how I functioned. So disrupting those habits and dismantling the frameworks I've always relied on led to some pretty dark and disorienting moments. I had to come to terms with the fact that I'd never seen a shiny medal I didn't want to win. And I had to reckon with the fact that chasing medals and merit badges damaged or destroyed relationships that I value. But what I found at the deepest layer of my inquiry was a quest for worthiness. The promotions, scholarships, leadership roles, and partnerships were progressively more damaging attempts to prove myself worthy. I wanted to have definitive proof that I was good enough, and I wanted evidence that maybe, just maybe, I was exceptional. I hoped that with every step up the ladder I took, I'd be a little closer to feeling like I was going to be okay. To work my way up the ladder, I would identify the next goal I needed to check off and then, always with limited information, calculate the fastest path to that achievement without regard for long-term ramifications. That meant I often found myself perched precariously on a ladder I didn't want to be on top of, but I felt compelled to just keep climbing. The drive to prove myself worthy of another step up dominated how I approached life, work, and even play, and it made me sick. At this point, you're probably either nodding along thinking, "Yeah, me too," or you're thinking, "Whoa, that's messed up." Maybe you're thinking both. It's taken a lot of work to get to the point where I can look back on my own story and see both sides. Ultimately, all of the striving toward worthiness, yearning to belong, and chasing other people's goals led, predictably, to burnout. That, combined with the devastating 2016 election, forced me to contemplate where I was and how I'd gotten there. When I tell the story, I always point to this time as the turning point, my wake-up call for finding a new way to organize my life. But of course, it was quite the process to start dismantling all of the narratives, assumptions, and conditioning that I had about myself and the world. I'd venture to say that I still have a long way to go, yet the vantage point I have now has proven valuable to others. So this book is the full story of my deconstruction, told through the lens of culture, commitment, practice, and process. It's how I discovered what kept me from going all in on my life and pursuing what mattered to me. It's also an interactive guide for deconstructing your own relationship to goals and the quest for worthiness. It's a blueprint for personal evolution without the compulsion to set higher goals or seek new ways to prove yourself. And finally, it's a look at how changing the way we show up in the world can positively impact our communities. My goal for this book has been to explore how we can use personal growth to foster community growth. My editor pointed out the irony of noting that I have a goal for this book when what I'm trying to do is critique the whole culture of goal setting. I laughed out loud when I read her comment. In most cases, I find other words that fit when using goal might be appropriate. For example, aim, target, objective. I'm not anti-goal, lowercase g. I'm anti-goal, uppercase g. We'll always have goals of one sort or another, and while I might use different language, I do acknowledge that, at some point, it becomes a matter of semantics. What I do take a position against is an individualist, ableist, pseudo-religious construction of goals. I stand for critical thinking about our goals, where they come from, who or what they really serve, and how we might be taking on cultural shoulds and supposed-tos that harm us and our communities. Most books that deal with goals, personal improvement or productivity, treat the individual as the source of both challenges and solutions. I want to offer an alternative, an approach that recognizes the structural issues and cultural contexts that make life harder than it needs to be. My hope is that you come to this book not looking for positive affirmations or a no-fail guide to success, but with an open mind, ready to explore some territory you might not have explored before. I believe that personal growth doesn't have to lead only to individual success. Personal growth can help us activate our communities, families, and friendships, the positive effects of which come back to us in spades. Adrienne Marie Brown put it this way: how we live and grow and stay purposeful in the face of constant change actually does determine both the quality of our lives and the impact that we can have when we move into action together. In the first two chapters, I explore how we've gotten to this point and why the experiences I describe are so universally familiar, whether through lived experience or observation. We venture down the validation spiral, as well as detangle the threads of rugged individualism, Protestant work ethic, and supremacy culture that shape our goal-setting impulses. In Chapter 3, I unpack how our identities become wrapped up in the goals we set, and the way those goals are performed for others, with special attention on how the internet has encouraged that performance. In Chapter 4, I contrast how we do things differently when we're focused on future achievement versus when we're present to daily practice and process. I also give you a better look at what it means to be all in when it comes to your life and work. Chapter 5 is about understanding our capacity, the resources we have, and how to use them. Chapters 6 through 10 contain the process I've created to organize my life around practice and process instead of goals. You'll learn how setting commitments about how you want to show up can change your life, as they've changed mine, and you'll explore how to give your life and work strategic direction without fixating on specific goals. You'll create your own comprehensive framework to guide your growth and organize your work. The final chapter offers guidance on follow-through, self-sabotage, and behavior change. I also talk about what happens when you inevitably can't stick to your plan and why that's a very good thing. And last, I offer you a few more tools for thinking critically about your choices and discovering what works for you. If you've started to question whether bigger goals, longer work hours, or productivity hacks are the best way to organize your life, you're in the right place. If you've started to wonder whether it's really your responsibility to fix the ways you are broken, this is for you. You might not yet have any idea what you want instead, and that's perfectly understandable. When I started to ask these same questions, I didn't have much of a grasp on specifics either. I just had a persistent inkling that I'd gotten way off course and needed to recalibrate. I yearned for a better way to be all in for myself and my community. And I'm betting that you feel, to one degree or another, similarly. Since then, my life has been full of reflection, analysis, and awareness building. While I'm more sure than ever that I don't want to climb the ladder anymore, I know that my default mode is still to try to ascend. My identity is still tightly wrapped around each rung. Every day is an opportunity to practice satisfaction rather than striving. Recently, I heard Sonia Renee Taylor, author of The Body Is Not an Apology, talk about our drive to climb the ladder. A line she said has stuck with me, boring itself into my very being. Taylor said, "The ladder is real, only because we keep trying to climb it." The aim of this book isn't just to help you ignore the ladder, or whatever yardstick you use to measure your worthiness. It's to show you how these measures don't even exist in the first place, and demonstrate that your worthiness doesn't come from how high you rise or how far you go, but because you exist. There is no higher or lower. There is no better or worse. There is no stronger or weaker. As we continue to reset our expectations and assumptions, we can take stock of what's truly important to us, to our businesses, to our work, to our families and our communities, instead of constantly taking stock of how we measure up or how much higher we have to climb. When we see that there is no ladder, we can finally go all in on the life and work that matters most to us. 1. The Validation Spiral. I couldn't shake the feeling of precariousness, that all that I'd worked for could just disappear, or reconcile it with an idea that had surrounded me since I was a child, that if I just worked hard enough, everything would pan out. Anne Helen Peterson, Can't Even, How Millennials Became the Burnout Generation. "Bingo!" I heard my classmate call out. I started to feel my eyes well up with tears. My second grade teacher noticed. She guided me out of the classroom and into the hall. She gently asked why on earth I was crying over a game of bingo. As only a precocious 8-year-old could, I tried to explain that I hated bingo because it required no skill. It was pure luck. There was no strategy to employ, no natural talent to rely on to win. Either your numbers were called or they weren't. I couldn't extract value out of a win. There was no meaning to victory, although loss still hurt. My teacher gently explained that it was just a game and encouraged me to enjoy it. But that's the thing. There has been nothing in my life that has been just a game. Every win was a small indication that things would work out, that I'd be okay. Every loss was a devastating reminder that I could lose everything, and probably would. What I couldn't quite explain at the time was that there was no way I could parlay a game of bingo into validation that I was good enough. Today I know this feeling, this fear, well. It's with me all the time. I'm self-conscious to admit that this continues to be an issue for me. I'm much more aware of it now, and I course-correct much more quickly. But in owning the fact that I still struggle, my hope is that this story, and this whole book, really, doesn't get thrown into the mountainous piles of stories of overcoming. I don't believe that we're supposed to transcend all of our challenges, congenital or cultural. I believe that recognizing the persistence of these challenges is key to maintaining our awareness, as well as acting to collectively make change. I constantly seek ways to prove myself good enough and validate my worthiness. I used to worry that I fixated on demonstrating that I was better than others, but I've come to.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.